So we're delighted to have Adam Bene Watts today. I knew Adam at MIT. He was working on cool things like nonlocal games and child-up circuits. And today he's going to be talking to us about non-commutative Nullstellensatz and perfect commuting operator strategies. So let's let him take it away. Thanks, Adam.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Daniel, for the introduction. And yeah, so I'm going to be talking about this, you know, this non-commutative Nullstellensatz, perfect commuting operator strategies for non-local games. It's based pretty much entirely on a paper that I wrote with Bill Helton and Igor Klep that is about to be on the archive, you know, hopefully in the next week or so. So it's imminent, but not there yet. And I will start with an introduction or an outline. And I realized I've only ever put outlines for my talks when I wanted to warn people about something. And this one's no different. So the warning here is that this is a sort of one thing that we do in the paper is we're sort of trying to bring together some theory from sort of non-commutative real algebraic geometry and some theory, you know, about non-local games and sort of smush them together. And a lot of the work there is just sort of defining things carefully and sort of getting everything lined up. And so that's what happens in the paper. It's also what's going to be what happens in the talk. So we're going to spend a lot of time, and maybe, you know, half of the talk, just sort of defining things and getting everything lined up correctly. And then the theorems are going to pop out pretty fast from those definitions. So that means a couple of things. It means we're going to, you know, spend a while on definitions. It means the definitions are going to be important. And I, you know, mostly I think it means that I'd like to encourage everyone to interrupt me while the definitions are happening if something's unclear. So that'll make the definitioning, you know, more interesting to get through, and also it'll help later on. So, you know, when things are being defined, if you have questions, please don't hesitate to interrupt. That's perfect and encouraged. All right, so let's get started. So I said we'd be defining things, and what are we going to define? It's basically just all the words in the title. So we're just going to go through the title defining everything. And we'll start with the word that is the longest and the one that I'm least qualified to talk about, and that is Nullstellensatz. So what is Nullstellensatz, or what are Nullstellensatz? If you translate it, it's a theorem about zeros, or sort of a zero locus theorem. I think it's a more literal translation. And there's a lot of them, and they all sort of talk about zeros of different types of polynomials. And I thought, just to give context, we'd warm up with sort of the simplest one, which is this one, that just talks about two polynomials. You know, we can consider univariate polynomials over the complex numbers. And it's a statement about when the conditions under which the zeros of one polynomial can be contained in the other. So there's the statement. I don't think I need to read it, but sort of here's a picture of what it's talking about. So there's a polynomial P, this orange line, polynomial Q, the blue one. And you see the zeros of Q are contained in the zeros of P. And in this case, that happens because, you know, P looks like Q times some other junk. And what this theorem over here says is that, you know, the only way that this can happen is if P looks like Q times some other junk, you know, maybe raised to some power, or I guess maybe square rooted. P to some power looks like Q times some other junk. So this is, and I'm not going to prove any of these statements, any of these Nullstellensatz, but sort of this statement hopefully looks sort of natural to people, like something that you might believe. All right. So if that's our warm up and this sort of looks okay to people, the next Nullstellensatz I'm going to show you is now a classical one. It's Hilbert's Nullstellensatz. And it's the same theorem as the one that we just looked at, except for I've upgraded to from Q from a single polynomial to a set of polynomials. So now you're talking about a set of polynomials. You're talking about the zeros of that set. So points where all the polynomials in that set are zero. And you're giving a condition for P, the zeros of the polynomial P, to contain the zeros of that set. And here's the condition. Again, it sort of says that P looks like the Q's times some other junk. And if you want to state, you know, this, an equivalent statement of this is to say that P to the Y is in the ideal generated by Q. And we'll say a lot more about ideals later, but if you like them already, this is just a more succinct way of saying what this thing over here says. Okay, and now I said I don't want to prove that, and I'm not going to, but I do sort of want to note something, and this is something that's going to remain true about all our Nullstellensatz, is sort of every time you have a Nullstellensatz, one direction is going to be the proof of one direction is going to be easier than the other. So sort of the point of a Nullstellensatz is you take a sort of a necessary condition that you understand, and then you show that it's sufficient. So in this case, to show that two implies one, you know, assume that P has this form that I have right here, and notice that if all the Qs evaluate to zero, the P evaluates to zero. And that's exactly what this statement here says, right? If all the Qs are zero, then P is zero. And now, so what the Nullstellensatz does is it takes that condition and it says that's, you know, a necessary and sufficient condition. So when that's true, you know, it's an if and only if. And the if and only if part of it is the sort of non-obvious part of the Nullstellensatz. But whenever we look at these statements, we're going to at least understand the proof of the obvious condition. So it'll be the criterion we hold our Nullstellensatz to. Okay, so here's a statement. Hopefully it looks okay to people. And now it might not seem clear, you know, what's useful about it or what the use is. Okay, so I've just copied the same statement up over here. And here's a weaker statement that's somehow more obviously useful. And that's the thing that's called the weak Nullstellensatz. And the weak Nullstellensatz, I take a set of polynomials Q, but instead of asking about a polynomial P, I'm just going to ask about, you know, what I'd call a solution to the set of all the polynomials Q. So just the existence of a point where all these polynomials are equal to zero. And this is, you know, immediately related to just the existence of a solution to a set of polynomial equations, because just take one hand, subtract it off from the other, and set that equal to zero. So the weak Nullstellensatz now is a condition telling you when a system of polynomial equations has a solution, this is the statement of it. So now I'm just using this ideal notation to say that, you know, I take things in Q, I multiply them with some junk, and I get one. And the weak Nullstellensatz follows very quickly from the strong one, or the full one. And here's the proof. So, you know, the crux of the proof is to take the full Nullstellensatz and set P equal to one. And it's sort of, you have to sound out what happens once to make this all make sense. If there is no solution to this set of polynomial equations, so if this set of polynomials Q has no zero, then the constant polynomial P equals one contains the zero set of the constant polynomial contains the zero set of Q. And that gives you one direction of this weak Nullstellensatz. And the other direction is our easy direction. If I can take all these Qs, multiply them together, and get one, well, then there can never be a point where they all evaluate to zero. So maybe I should just let you stare at that for a sec. But I'll say, I guess, that from here on out, we're going to be working with Nullstellensatz of this form, these sort of weak Nullstellensatz. And the point to take, I guess, you know, the key point is that we're taking a question about sort of existence of a solution to a set of polynomial equations, and we're turning it into this nice algebraic condition where I just check, you know, membership of an element one in some ideal. I just check whether I can multiply polynomials together and get one. Okay. One more thing to do before we leave classical land, and that's to say that everywhere here, we've been working with polynomials over C, sort of complex valued polynomials. But there's also real Nullstellensatz. So classical real Nullstellensatz just means that instead of working over, you know, the complex numbers, I work over the reals. And so here is, we're picking up adjectives, a real weak classical Nullstellensatz. And it looks just the same as the weak Nullstellensatz above, except for I also put in sums of squares. So what is a sum of squares? It's a sum of polynomials squared. The condition is down there. But maybe, I realize I've thrown a lot at you. We're sort of just warming up by looking at a lot of examples. This one, it's maybe worth checking now the easy direction of the Nullstellensatz and making sure that we believe that. So what's the easy direction here? If minus one is in this ideal plus a sum of squares, Notice that, if minus one is in this ideal plus a sum of squares, then you want to say that there can't exist a solution to all these polynomial equations. So to see that that's true, assume not two and one. So we'll do this in the slides later, but I realize it might be worth doing now. And the point I just want to make is if I plug in numbers for these q's and I get zero for everything here, the sum of squares has to evaluate to something positive, and I get minus one, and that gives me a contradiction. So if that seemed confusing, don't worry, I'll do it in slides later. If that was helpful, that's good. But we're sort of just warming up by looking at these things anyways. Okay, so that's just a brief survey of a bunch of classical Nullstellensatz, sort of the form that they take. And now I want to give you another word in the definition, and that's this non-commutative. So, we're thinking about Nullstellensatz, not over the classical, not classical Nullstellensatz, but non-commutative Nullstellensatz. And what does that mean? That means that we're migrating to this sort of this new field of what's called non-commutative real algebraic geometry. So I just want to give you sort of a translation between commutative algebraic geometry, think about polynomials, and what people think about when they say non-commutative algebraic geometry. So everything that I've done so far has been commutative algebraic geometry. I've just been talking about polynomials over the complex numbers. Non-commutative algebraic geometry, I'm not talking about polynomials over the complex numbers. I'm talking about elements of some star algebra. But how should you think about this? It's just to say that I'm thinking about sort of polynomials and non-commuting variables. So I take a bunch of variables. Here I have just variables x1, x2, they commute, I multiply them together, I get a polynomial. In a star algebra, I have variables, I multiply them together. I can do exactly the same thing, except for now x1s and x2s don't commute. So this thing x3, x1, x3 is a different element than x3 squared x1. And I also have a star operation that I can stick on these things. Okay, and in classical land, we kept evaluating our polynomials on points, right? I had polynomials, and to sort of, the natural thing that you do with a polynomial is you stick in a value, values for x1, x2, x3, you plug those into the polynomial, you get a complex number out. So when you're in the sort of non-commutative setting, what replaces evaluation of a polynomial on a point? And this is sort of the first subtle or surprising thing. The points in the non-commutative setting are representations. So there's two notations for this. And I'll state the easier one first. Instead of evaluating on points, you could just imagine substituting in matrices, right? Here, everything was commuting, so I could just stick in complex numbers. But if I want to sort of stick in something explicit for these non-commuting variables, a sort of natural example of things that don't commute are matrices. So if you imagine just substituting a matrix for x1, a matrix for x2, yada, yada, this is sort of, people tend to use this notation P of x. But that's exactly the same thing as saying that I take a representation of this element from the star algebra and map it into the space of matrices, or sort of more generally, the space of bounded operators acting on some Hilbert space. So that's what this notation is doing. And I think people use these notations, the sort of P of big X, or this representation notation sort of interchangeably. My brain sort of keeps disliking this P of X notation for no good reason. So in this talk, we're going to just use this pi of P. But sort of the thing to get from this part of the slide is just to realize that in the non-commutative setting, instead of plugging in complex numbers and getting out a complex number, I'm plugging in, let's say, operators and multiplying them together and getting out some operator that's acting on the Hilbert space. And that's, evaluation in this NC algebraic geometry setting. Okay, and the last point, classically, what was happening, we're going to talk about Nullstellensatz, which are theorems about zeros. Classically, it's sort of easy to understand what a zero is. I just, plug in now complex numbers, I get zero out. But what replaces a zero in this non-commutative setting? Because remember, I'm plugging in now matrices or operators, I'm getting operators out. So what does it mean for an operator to be zero? And there's a few different definitions. You could talk, you know, they're all good ones. You could talk about hard zeros, which is sort of maybe the natural translation where you just say the operator itself is zero. You can talk about these things called directional zeros, where now, you know, if you think about the operator as a matrix for a second, I don't demand that the matrix be zero. I just demand that the matrix have a zero eigenvalue. So I demand that there exists some vector psi in the Hilbert space such that this operator acting on the vector psi is equal to zero. Or you can talk about these things called determinantal zeros, where I just demand that the determinant of the operator be equal to zero. Okay, so this was all perspective, but the thing that I want to point out now, and the thing to notice that'll be important later, is that this definition right here of directional zeros is exactly what, you know, us on sort of the physics or quantum information side would just, you know, call an eigenvalue equation. So anytime that you're sort of, you know, I'm just demanding that this operator have a zero eigenvalue on psi. Or similarly, I could take an equation involving eigenvalues and subtract everything over to one side. So anytime that you're talking about eigenvalues, if you just want a simple translation, you know, you're talking about directional zeros of operators. That's sort of an observation that we're going to get a lot of mileage out of in this talk. Okay, so motivated by all of that, and sort of remembering the form of Nullstellensatz, you know, what is a good Nullstellensatz for talking about eigenvalues of operators? What we want is, you know, a weak, non-commutative, real directional zeros Nullstellensatz. And luckily, such a thing exists. And here's a statement. And this one I'll read out because it's actually important. We're going to use it later. So I take some star algebra and I ask, you know, for a necessary and sufficient condition for a bunch of eigenvalue equations to be satisfied on representations of this star algebra. So I ask, well, first I ask, is there a representation of this star algebra where a bunch of elements in the star algebra all have a common zero eigenvalue? That's what this is saying is, I want a representation. So I want to be able to take the elements in this algebra, turn them into explicit matrices or operators. And I want a state in the space that they're acting on such that all of these elements have zero eigenvalue acting on the state. So this is exactly, you know, asking something about eigenvalues of these operators. And it turns out this is true if and only if this algebraic condition is satisfied. So what is this algebraic condition? It's a condition that lives, you know, stated entirely in terms of the star algebra. And I'll just say it in words. You know, -1 is in the left ideal generated by the set that's supposed to vanish, plus the star of that left ideal, plus sums of squares. Okay. And now maybe the best way to parse this or to sort of get just a vague sense of what it's talking about is to do the same thing we did in the classical Nullstellensatz setting, where we're going to understand one direction. We're going to understand that this condition is sufficient for this fact. Or maybe they ran, but you'll see the proof in a sec. Sorry, there's negation there. Okay, so we're gonna prove the easy direction. And what is that? It's that if 1 is true and 2 is false, we have a contradiction. Okay, so it can't be the case that 1 is in the left ideal plus the star of the left ideal plus the sum of squares, and there's a representation pi where all these things vanish. Okay, so how does that proof go? Well, assume this representation exists. Then this is just the statement that, you know, this is the statement the representation exists, pi of s psi equals zero. If I left multiply pi of s by some junk, I've still got to get zero. And that's exactly what a left ideal does. And if I take the star of all of that, then I've also got to get zero. I mean, star of zero is zero. So pi acting on anything in the left ideal times psi gives me zero. The star of that statement tells me that psi star acting on anything in pi of L of S star also has to give me zero. And sums of squares, what are those? Well, when I represent a sum of squares, I just get a PSD operator, positive semi-definite operator. So positive semi-definite operators have positive eigenvalue. And that's all that's happening here. And then the contradiction is exactly the same as the one that I said just sort of very briefly and vaguely a couple slides ago. You know, minus one acting on psi star psi, or psi star pi of minus one psi, that's going to be a negative number. But we just argued that pi times this left ideal, that gives me zero. Pi times this thing gives me zero, sandwiched between these psis, and pi on the sums of squares has to give me something positive. So the contradiction just ends up taking the form, you know, minus one is greater than or equal to zero. That's our contradiction. And okay, that's the easy direction. That shows that this is, you know, that shows one part of this implication. And the other implication, I'm not going to prove now. I mean, we're just going to sort of, it's this sort of general form of the Nullstellensatz where you get something, a condition that's necessary and show that it's also sufficient. But maybe if people really want to talk about the proof, you should ask me something at the end. But I'll say my co-authors are the, you know, experts on this part of the paper anyways. I think one or both of them are in the talk somewhere. But okay, hopefully people just have a general sense for this statement. And maybe a sense that it's, you know, something that's perhaps useful for talking about eigenvalue problems in physics or in computer science or in quantum information. Okay, let's pause all of that and go down. Actually, no, sorry, let me just stop here. Now's a great time to ask questions on the Nullstellensatz end if you have them, because we're about to switch gears for a second, talk about nonlocal games, and then smush everything together. But if there aren't questions, I'll assume that's a good sign.
Hi, Adam.
Howdy, howdy.
In the previous slide, can you explain a bit why, how the three notions of the zeros came about, like the motivation for it, sort of?
Yeah, yeah, I can. And maybe, you know, I don't quite have the history right, but let me just say, or I don't have the history right on hand. Bill probably does. But, you know, I guess just the observation that, you know, when you're not dealing, you know, when your objects become operators, right? You evaluate these polynomials with a representation pi. You have an operator. You know, maybe you're given a freedom to define all these things as zeros. You know, all of these things are things that you could think of as a zero of the operator. And I guess the important thing is that you get statements like Nullstellensatz for all three of these definitions of zeros.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, they're all useful definitions of zeros is maybe the best thing to say.
I see.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Is that a question from Ben too? Yeah, hi.
Yeah, hi. Can you comment on the relationship between the directional zeros and the determinantal zeros? I mean, it looks like every determinantal zero would be a directional zero, and maybe almost the other way too.
Good. So let's see. Bill, so in gen, okay, so certainly I think it's safe to say that these are sort of weaker notions of zero as you go down, right? You know, if you have a hard zero, you definitely are a directional zero. A directional zero, yes, implies a determinantal zero. The thing that happens in a directional zero that maybe isn't clear from this definition is if I demand a directional zero of a set, I demand that all the elements in the set have a common zero eigenvector. So, you know, saying that all these elements have a determinantal zero is like saying they all have zero eigenvalue. Saying that they all have a common directional zero is like saying that they have a zero eigenvalue on the same vector psi, or a zero eigenvalue in the same direction. Does that make sense?
Okay, thanks, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that's this here. There's a unique state psi, I should say, you know, such that this condition holds.
Yeah, I mean, one feature is that you're keeping track of more information with a directional zero. So you, with the determinantal zero, you're only, you're not keeping track of the psi. With the directional zero, you're keeping track of the psi. So if you say that the directional zeros of P contain the directional zeros of Q, that means that the psis for the P and the psis for the Q are
the same,
containing. Whereas with the determinantal zeros, if you say that you have this containment, it's just the locations, the pies essentially that are that have containment. The size don't enter the statement.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. These questions are heartening because that means people are following along somewhat. So thank you for them. In the interest of time, let me hop over and just say some vague things about non-local games, or some specific things about non-local games, but say them quickly. Because the goal, you know, the paper is to take a question in non-local games and take this non-commutative Nullstellensatz formulation, smush them together and get something nice out. So, okay. I assume people here have some familiarity with non-local games. So I'll go fast. But what is a non-local game? It's sort of a formulation of a way. We're now in the field of quantum information, and a non-local game is sort of a test of the ability of correlations, the ability of quantum mechanics to produce correlations, or the ability of different possible types of physics to produce correlations. So what happens in a non-local game is you imagine some players, usually called Alice and Bob, who are separated and share some resource, you know, often entanglement, it could be something else. And you have this verifier. The verifier chooses some questions from a universe of questions, and you can safely just assume the questions are integers. Sends those questions to the players. The players send back some responses. We can also assume that they're integers or sort of vectors of integers sometimes. And then these questions and responses are all scored according to this function, the scoring function that's known. And the goal of the players is to achieve as high a score as possible. The problem is the players can't communicate. So, you know, Bob doesn't know the question Alice gets. Alice doesn't know the question Bob gets. And so, you know, their ability to maximize this score sort of depends on their ability to correlate their responses. That's very quick setup. And sort of in terms of terminology, you know, what you need to specify one of these non-local games, I guess every non-local game tests something, some non-local games are better tests than others. What you need to specify a non-local game is I need to specify, I guess, first M and N, so how big the question set size is, how big the response set size is, and then I need to give you a probability distribution telling you the likelihood of a given question pair, IJ, being sent to the players, and I need to tell you the scoring function that tells you, you know, what responses are considered good responses, what responses are considered bad responses. And just by convention, the scoring function will always give a score between 0 and 1 to any question response pair. Okay. And now this whole picture was for two players. There's a K player variant of all of this. You know, sort of, you can generalize trivially to K players at the cost of making your notation worse. Okay, not trivially. But, you know, nothing crazy happens except for your notation gets worse when you're talking about K players. So now, you know, you've got a vector of K questions, a vector of K responses scored just the same. So for this talk, you know, when it's easy, we're going to stick to two players, but sometimes we're going to, you know, sometimes we're going to prove statements for two players, even though they hold for K players, just for the sake of notation. Okay, so that's a non-local game. Good, we're getting through a lot of the words. Next, we just need to talk about perfect commuting operator strategies. So what is a commuting operator strategy? It's a description of how players that share what you'd call commuting operator resources can cooperate with each other to produce responses in a non-local game. So to describe a commuting operator strategy, what do I need? I tell you a Hilbert space. I tell you a state. And that's the state that we imagine the players sharing when they play this non-local game. And I tell you projectors. And I use this funny notation, E of alpha IA, and you can just read this thing as being the projector that the alpha player uses, and it corresponds to question I and answer A. And what does all that mean? Well, here's sort of the meaningful statement, that the probability that the players are given questions I, and so if the players are given questions I and J, the probability that they send responses A and B is given by this thing. If you're a physicist, you can turn this psi star into a bra and this psi into a cat. You know, these projectors, you could imagine, they're just projectors corresponding to eigenvalues of some measurement that the players make on the state. So it's just sort of a way of describing, in maybe a slightly roundabout way, an observable that the players measure. And there's also relations that these projectors have to satisfy. And in particular, you know, I guess they're projectors, so that covered most of them. But the other thing that I have to tell you is that Alice and Bob can't communicate while the game is happening, which is the same thing as saying that these projectors have to commute for different players. So E1 commutes with E2, commutes with E3, so on and so forth. Okay. And once you have this statement written down, you know, once you can compute the probability that the players are give two responses, sent two questions, you can compute the expected score that the players achieve playing a game. So that's just this messy thing here. We won't do much with it, but it's sort of good to write it down and convince yourself that it at least works. And I've just stuck the, you know, important business end of everything in blue. Okay. And now, what's the big deal here? Or, you know, the thing to keep in mind is that I told you that the commuting operator strategy, I have to specify the Hilbert space, but I didn't give any bound on the dimension of that Hilbert space. So in particular, players can share some complicated infinite dimensional, well, some complicated state in some infinite dimensional Hilbert space, have very complicated sets of projectors that they use to produce responses. And you know, there's games for which this is necessary. And that's sort of where a lot of the richness of, you know, these questions about commuting operator strategies comes from. So there's a lot more that can be said there, but we're just sort of skating by this. But okay, this is sort of a standard way of describing a commuting operator strategy. I want to tell you now something slightly different that's going to sort of let us attack these, let us avoid this infinite dimensional weirdness just a little bit. And that's going to be to introduce something that other people have introduced before with slightly different names, but I'm going to call for this talk the universal game algebra U. So you can see we're starting to try and move towards the Nullstellensatz. What is the universal game algebra? Well, it's a star algebra generated by elements, these things E alpha IA, which are just sort of stand-ins for the projectors that I defined on the previous page. So I'm going to, you know, what's the star algebra generated by these things mean? It means I just take these things, I multiply them together, I add them together, and I can put complex numbers in front of them, right? So I'm just, you know, making, you know, just making polynomials, non-commutative polynomials in these things, but these things satisfy some relations. And they satisfy the relations that the projectors defined in the previous page satisfied. So they're projectors, they square to themselves, they star to themselves. If you sum over all the possible responses to a given question, you get one. That's like saying that these projectors together form an observable or define a complete set of outcomes. And they commute. This is also sort of a natural one saying that they're projectors onto different outcomes of a measurement. You could think of this one as saying, and this one says that Alice and Bob can't communicate. Projectors corresponding to different players have to commute with each other. So this universal game algebra U, all we've done is sort of abstract these capital E's that I had that lived on some specific Hilbert space to just sort of formal variables that live in some star algebra. And now to define a commuting operator strategy with this universal game algebra, what do I have to do? Well, I have to represent U onto bounded operators acting on some Hilbert space. So, you know, we're just defining a commuting operator strategy in a different way. We're starting with this universal game algebra U, and then to actually get, you know, the capital E's, well, we just represent elements of the universal game algebra. And then I have to give you a state, psi, in this Hilbert space, which is the one shared by the players. So at the end of all of this, all I've done is I've, you know, given you this sort of tuple notation for talking about commuting operator strategies, where instead of talking about a commuting operating strategy using what I had on the previous page with Hilbert space, yada, yada. We talked about this universal game algebra and then just described a commuting operator strategy via this representation and state in the space.
Adam, can I interrupt you?
Yeah, please.
I didn't catch that.
Sorry, you cut out for a second there too. What did you say?
Can you Can you explain the third condition on this list of four conditions here? Like, what? Why do these projectors have to be equal to zero here?
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Think of the capital E's for a second as sort of projectors onto different outcomes of some observable.
Okay.
So this alpha tells you we're dealing with the same player. The I tells you you're dealing with the same question. And the A and the B are just different outcomes.
Okay. Yeah, I got
so,
it. Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Yeah, actually, if you weren't in a star algebra, I think if you had represented things, this summing to one condition would be enough to imply this. But in the star algebra, you need both of these, is my rough understanding. It certainly doesn't hurt to demand it anyways. Okay. Right, but we've got this nice pi psi notation for talking now about commuting operator strategies. Okay, I put it in bold. Okay, and now the next thing is just, it's an exercise. Take the definition from the previous page that give you, you know, these probabilities and the expected score. And the only thing that's happened is I've taken the capital E's and turned them into pi of lowercase e's. But, you know, just to sort of convince yourself that pi psi is a totally fine way of describing a strategy. Okay. Last word, and then we've got the theorems. So we talked about commuting operator strategies. Now we need perfect commuting operator strategies. So there's the definition of a commuting operator strategy in perfect. It just sort of says that you achieve the maximum possible expected score. So I guess in words, you know, for any question that you send the players, there's some responses. You could imagine a game set up so that for every question you send the players, there's some responses that achieve a score of exactly one. If the players always return a score, those responses. So if they always get a score of one, no matter what, you'd call the strategy that they're following perfect. And now we're going to take, you know, sort of that informal definition of a strategy being perfect and write down some conditions that I can give about these pi size. And one way to say it is to say that responses achieving a score of less than one never occur. So, you know, if there's a question that can be sent to the players and there's responses the players can return that achieves a score of less than one, well, then the probability of those responses being sent back to the verifier has to be equal to zero. And now there's one small trick that we're going to use, you know, one equivalence is that sort of this inner product being equal to zero is the same thing as just saying that pi of these two things acting on psi is equal to zero. And why is that? That's because these guys are PSD. So the eigenvalues are all greater than or equal to zero. If the inner product is zero, that just means that these things vanish on the state psi. There's an equivalent condition that maybe if you're thinking about these things as projectors is even more natural. Is to say that, you know, the responses obtaining a score of one occur with probability one. So the players are guaranteed to send a correct response if the strategy that they're following is perfect. So it's a little more wordy. You know, for any question pair that can be sent to the players, take the set of all responses that obtain a score of one. Now, if we sum up all the projectors onto those responses obtaining a score of one, the probability of a response from that set being sent back has to be equal to one. So this inner product of this, you know, combination of projectors, still a projector with psi. So psi, this combination of projectors, has to be equal to one, just tells you that psi has to be in the one eigenspace of this combination of projectors, which is the same thing as saying that this combination of projectors minus one has to vanish on psi. So that was maybe a lot in words, but I'll let you look at the equations for a sec. What we're doing, right, is we're lining things up so that we can hit everything with the Nullstellensatz. That's, you know, not clear yet. It'll be clear in a couple of slides. But basically, we can translate this perfect condition always into sort of a set of eigenvalue constraints. And here's just a definition that sort of generalizes these first two cases and gives us a little more freedom. So we're going to say that a nonlocal game is determined by a set of elements if the representation of all the elements in that set vanishing on the state psi is enough to guarantee that the representation and psi define a perfect commuting operator strategy. So when a nonlocal game is determined by a set of elements, that's saying that if I only care about whether or not a strategy is perfect for this nonlocal game, all I have to do is check what that, you know, what that strategy, what that pi psi does to the elements in the set F. And if all the elements in the set F vanish, then I know pi psi is a perfect commuting operator strategy. So there's sort of two example constructions of how you get determining sets up here. You can take the elements corresponding to losing outcomes. You can take the elements corresponding to winning outcomes minus one, and you've got more freedom. So you could do something else if you really felt like it. I mean, there's sort of, we're not, I don't want to rule out possibilities. For certain games, you could construct more sort of elaborate determining sets. But that's what this notation lets you do. And okay, I said we'd get sort of all the ducks lined up and then the first result would follow. And that's just happened. So here's our definition of a determining set. Here was our weak, non-commutative, real directional zeros, Nullstellensatz. And if you map just condition two here, you know, it says the representation of all the elements F and F have to vanish to condition one here, what you get, you know, they match, right? The statement that pi of F psi equals zero for all F and F is just the statement that the set of elements S determines, I guess, a common directional zero for this representation. So I feel like, you know, I feel like that sentence was less helpful than just reading these two statements will be. But you know, here's the result of smushing everything together now. You have a perfect commuting operator strategy, tells you that you've got these eigenvalue constraints, these eigenvalue equations are satisfied by some representation. And then Nullstellensatz tells you that these eigenvalue constraints can be satisfied by some representation if and only if minus one is not in this left ideal plus the star of the left ideal plus the sums of squares. All right. And so this is pretty nice, right? This gives us just sort of a direct translation of a question about nonlocal games to a sort of algebraic statement that lives entirely in this star algebra U that I've defined. Now I've got maybe five, a little bit more minutes. So we'll go fast, but we'll get through this. This is a slide with too much text that you don't need to pay attention to the details of. But the point I just want to say is that, so we just got a very general all-purpose algebraic characterization of when games have perfect commuting operator strategies. But now sort of previously, there's lots of families of games, you know, synchronous games, linear systems games, XOR games that maybe mean some things to you. And for each of these games, people sort of had special case algebraic characterizations. And now this slide really isn't supposed to convey much information. Anything in red is something that I just haven't defined and I'm not going to define. But you know, for all of these sort of families of games, there's already statements about algebras or about groups that sort of characterize when a game has a perfect commuting operator strategy. Now, if there's one thing that maybe I do want you to notice on this slide, and it's something very basic. It's you know, the condition that we just saw had a star algebra in it. The synchronous game condition has a star algebra in it. These two, linear systems games and XOR games, you know, they both involve the word group. They both talk about groups. And so that, you know, that alone raises a pretty good question, which is that if, you know, what's the relationship between this condition that we just derived that was sort of vague and sort of general and works with a star algebra and all, you know, where are the groups coming from if we sort of start with our condition and keep on moving? So in the last sort of five-ish, six-ish minutes, let me sort of show you what happens there. So just going to show you a second theorem now that sort of explains where the groups come from in some of these special cases. But maybe this is also a good pause and ask for questions point, actually, either here or the slide before, if people have any questions about this in particular. Now, questions now, I feel like, you know, if you ask a question now, I'll just take it out of the time at the end. So I know I was rushing, but, you know, ask questions here if it's super relevant, because what we're going to do next is sort of moving on to a more specific version of this statement. All right. Okay, so what do we want to do next? We want to get to groups. I think I've got time. Okay, so where are the groups coming from? So the first thing that you should notice is that this universal game algebra that I defined, you know, 4 or 5 slides ago, it's a group algebra. So what does that mean? It means I can define a group, and then elements of this algebra look like just, you know, elements of the group added together, multiplied by, you know, some constants. And here is a construction that works for games when there's only 2 responses. And it's sort of actually very, it's straightforward enough that I'll just say it. You could think of this XAI as being an eigenvalue, a projector onto, you know, you could think of this XAI, sorry, as being a projector, right? And you can turn this projector into an observable where you just have a 1 and a -1 eigenspace. So, you know, this is maybe a standard construction. You take 1 -2 times the projector, and now you've got a 1 eigenspace and a -1 eigenspace sort of coming off of this projector. And it turns out that these observables now form a group. These observables square to the identity. They're self-adjoint. They're their own inverse, right? And you get commutativity relations for these observables that come off of the commutativity relations of the projectors. So that's all that's happening in these 2 points. And I've been calling them observables. They're not. They're still formal variables, but they represent into observables under some pi. So sort of for the purpose of explanation, I said observables. Really, I should have been a little more careful and just saying that these were elements. These are still elements of U. But you know, these elements of U form a group. And I can talk about U as just being the group algebra generated by these elements. Okay, why did I go through all of that? Because of this definition. It's just gonna be sort of a nice type of determining set, where we're gonna say that a set is torically determined now if there exists a determining set. So remember, these are things that have to vanish on psi. But your determining set has this sort of special form where elements of your determining set look like some constant, some complex number, times an element of the group -1. And we'll see an example of this in a sec. So let me just put this out there as a definition. One more thing that I should say, right? This part here, just the beta g's, are the things that we're going to call the clauses. So this f has to vanish on psi. These beta g's, you could think of them as things that have to fix psi. You know, pi of beta g acting on psi has to be equal to psi. So a game that is torically determined has sort of a set of these beta g elements such that that has to fix psi, meaning that psi has to be in the 1 eigenspace of a bunch of these beta g's. So sort of very loosely, a game being torically determined is saying is that I can find these observables and a strategy is perfect if and only if psi is in the 1 eigenspace of these observables. That's sort of what this torically determined setting says, is that I can collect a bunch of observables and I ask that the game is really asking whether or not there exists a vector in the 1 eigenspace of all of these observables. And those observables are these things that we call the clauses. Okay, now what happens if your game is torically determined? Well, then the following are equivalent. You get a statement like what we had in the Nullstellensatz, but without the sum of squares. Or you get this other funny statement that says that There's no complex number other than one in the group generated by the clauses. Okay, so what does that mean? Again, let's just get intuition by proving the easy direction. And I guess it's not quite on the page, so you're just gonna have to bear with me. But remember I said the clauses are things that have to fix psi, right? You have a perfect commuting operator strategy if and only if you have something in the one eigenspace of all of the clauses. But now if I can multiply the clauses together and get a complex number other than one, then I've got a problem, because the clauses are supposed to fix psi. A product of the clauses are supposed to fix psi means that some complex number other than one is supposed to fix psi, means that, you know, psi is equal to some complex number times psi. And that's our contradiction. So if you want, just imagine that beta is equal to minus one. And what you end up saying is that psi is equal to minus psi. And so that's the contradiction that comes. And this theorem sort of says that searching for contradictions of that form for torically determined games gives you a necessary and sufficient condition. And what's an example of this theorem? I think I'll skip the math. So let's skip that proof. But let's just look at this, is that XOR games are torically determined. And they're torically determined by things that look like plus or minus some product of the X's. These are the one minus one valued observables I defined a few slides ago. And so because of all of that, and because of this theorem, all you have to do to check whether or not an XOR game has a perfect commuting operator strategy is to multiply together these, is to ask whether or not by multiplying together these one minus one valued observables, I can get minus one. So, sorry. Checking existence of a perfect commuting operator strategy for an XOR game is just the same thing as asking whether minus one is in the group generated by the products of these observables. And again, I'm speaking loosely. These are only observables once they're represented. But either way, asking whether or not minus one is in this group. And that's exactly the, you know, condition, the necessary and sufficient condition for an XOR game that we had a couple slides back. You can do a similar thing for linear systems games. You can do a different thing for synchronous games, which I've got some bonus slides to talk about, but I don't think we'll get to. But I think that sort of covers the big point here, is that if you sort of follow this XOR game example, you understand what happens for what sort of the point of this torically determined games theorem. Okay, and then since I've got just 5 minutes left, let me just close by asking, you know, all right, so that's good. We have a tool, we have two tools. What's it possibly good for? There's a few things, right? And I'll just say them quickly. One is that you can always imagine, you know, it's always nice to have sort of algebraic statements because you can imagine turning them into programs. And there's sort of a natural semi-definite programming hierarchy you can read off of this sort of thing. So if you like NCSOS and sums of squares type things, you know, this gives you a condition that you can check to check whether or not a game has a perfect commuting operator strategy. Of course, there already exists a nice condition. It's this sort of non-commutative sums of squares hierarchy, or NPA, if you like that. This is a different condition. It's related. It might be better. It might be worse. You know, it's just another useful tool. The other thing is that sort of we have these examples that I sort of alluded to at the end, where you get the nice formulations of XOR games or linear systems games or synchronous games out of this more general statement. And so if you can do that, well, maybe you can generalize, right? Maybe if you understand how XOR games and linear, where XOR and linear system games come from, you can sort of get a bigger class of games that sort of have these nice characterizations. And then the other thing that I sort of like is that if you understand where these nice characterizations come from, you can ask about games that don't have any of them. I mean, sort of, we sort of understand how to study XOR games and linear system games and synchronous games, but are there games for which none of these techniques work, you know, for which sort of games without any of these nice structures? And those are maybe interesting things to look at for sort of new, you know, those games might have new and interesting properties that we don't see in games with all of this nice structure. So sort of understanding this nice structure is nice because you can look for games that have it, or you can look for games that don't. And we'll skip this synchronous games bonus stuff, but we can talk about it later. I think I should just hover on the references for a sec so that anyone who's, you know, watching a recording of this and wants to look at them, it's there, but it's also in the paper. And thanks. But also questions are lovely, you know, please.
Yeah, so we certainly have a few minutes for questions if people have them. Maybe I'll start. Adam, you mentioned like the first point of your open questions. You said something about using this to prove that games do have a perfect commuting strategy. Like,
yeah.
So are there concrete examples of that?
Only very silly ones, I think. Well, oh, sorry, no. Let me rephrase. There are concrete examples of that, but the concrete example that I know is for XOR games that was an actually, you know, it wasn't this condition, it was the sort of group condition of XOR games that comes from this condition. But yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, sort of in general, you know, a game has a perfect commuting operator strategy if -1 is not in this thing, right? But this thing is infinite. And so, you know, you can't, you know, you can rule out, you know, at some degree that -1 is not in this thing, but you can't rule out that -1 isn't in this thing at all without some extra structure or some extra argument. But if a game is nice, you might be able to find that.
But you might be able to show that a game doesn't have a perfect commuting operator strategy if you can.
Yes. In fact, you will always be able to, in the sense that there will always be a certificate of this form of some degree. But all that gives you is that the question of deciding whether or not a game has a perfect commuting operator strategy is in Kilari, which, you know, there's an algorithm that will terminate in one direction, which we already knew from NPA, for example.
I see.
Yeah.
I have a like more basic question on commuting operator yeah. strategies. If there is a, like, does a commuting operator strategy imply a quantum strategy, or does it generalize?
Yes, generalize is the word. So when you say quantum strategy, you probably mean this, you know, this thing in the closure of the tensor product strategies. Is that what you're imagining?
Yeah.
Yeah, so here we never demanded anything about sort of a tensor product structure on the Hilbert space, right? We said there's Hilbert space, Alice and Bob, you know, make measurements on it and they share a state. Now, if the Hilbert space is finite dimensional, it turns out that commuting operator implies tensor product. So if you have a commuting operator strategy on a finite dimensional Hilbert space, you can find a separable Hilbert space, you know, where there's an Alice Hilbert space and a Bob Hilbert space, and the state looks like, yeah. In the infinite dimensional case, that's not true. So there are, you know, games that have perfect commuting operator strategies, but not tensor product strategies, and actually not perfect quantum strategies. And that statement is the content of the MIPSTAR paper, the Nataraj and Vijay MIPSTAR equals RE.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, thank you.
Welcome. I think, go for it, Anirvan.
This is probably a nonsensical question, but are there like fermionical Gaussian versions of strategies with like bounded particle number, perhaps? Just curious.
I don't know. Probably you'd pick them all up with commuting operator.
Okay.
Although maybe, oh no, sorry. Maybe I take that all back because you've got some, I don't know. I'll just say that.
All right.
Yeah, okay, Let me say something even vaguer, which is that, you know, Nullstellensatz and eigenvalue equations show up in sort of local Hamiltonian, you know, there's other settings where you might use this Nullstellensatz. If you drop the strategy part of it and just ask about the Nullstellensatz and the eigenvalue equation, you know, then then there's probably fermionic and Gaussian examples where this Nullstellensatz might be useful or might not.
Okay.